Hello, my friends. Welcome to this week's Word Study. Today, we're going to talk about the differences that we see in the Word between the kingdom of God and the kingdom of heaven. That is, the malchut of Elohim and the malchut of the Shamayim. Now, some assert that the kingdom of heaven and the kingdom of God refer to the same thing, while others say that they are two different kingdoms. Personally, I'm not perfectly sure. I tend to think that in many ways they are referring to the same thing. And perhaps in some ways not so. However, we look at Matithyahu and Marcos, and we compare Matthew 4:17, which reads, "The kingdom of heaven is at hand." Mark 1:15 says, "The kingdom of God is at hand." Matthew chapter 5, verse 3 says, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven." Whereas Luke 6:20 says, "Blessed are the poor, for yours is the kingdom of God." Matthew 11:11 says, "Among those born of women, there has not risen a greater than John the Baptist. Notwithstanding, he who is least in the kingdom of heaven is greater than him." Yohanan the Immerser. However, in Luke chapter 7, verse 28, we see, "Among those born of women, there is not a greater prophet than Yohanan the Immerser," John the Baptist, "but he who is least in the kingdom of God is greater than him." We can see that these are interchangeable. Matthew 13:11, "The mysteries of the kingdom of heaven." Mark 4:11 and Luke 8:10, "The mysteries of the kingdom of God." So they do appear to be synonymous. However, you know, when we look at the Odiote, we'll see that there are some differences between Elohim, we see as God, and Shamayim, we see as heaven. And even there, when we see Shamayim, sometimes it may have said Yahweh, but we'll get to that in a minute. The kingdom of God, that is the Malchut of Elohim, appears 69 times in Matthew through 2 Thessalonians. For example, Matthew, Matithyahu, chapter 6, verse 10 says, "Father, your kingdom come, your malchut come, your will be done on earth as it is in the Shamayim, as it is in heaven." Matthew 6:33, "First and most importantly, seek, aim at, strive after his malchut, his kingdom, and his righteousness," not our own, his way of doing things, his way of being right. We learn that by studying the Word. The attitude and the character of Elohim. Seek those things. And all these things will be added to you, will be taken care of for you. You make Elohim number one on a list of one in your life. And he'll take care of all these things that most people tend to worry about and make a mess about. Matthew chapter 19, verse 24. "Again, I tell you, it's easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle." Here we go with the English. It's not talking about a camel trying to go through the eye of a needle. That makes it sound impossible. In fact, it would be impossible. No, the original language is saying that it's easier for a camel to go through the doorway of a tent, which is not impossible, but boy, it could be very chaotic. It's easier for a camel to go through the doorway of a tent than it is for a rich man, someone who places his faith in wealth and status, money and power. Easier for a camel to go through the door of a tent than someone who puts all their faith and money and power to enter the Malchut of Elohim. Luke 17, 20 and 21. Now, having been asked by the Pharisees when the Malchut of Elohim would come, he replied, Yeshua speaking, "The Malchut of Elohim is not coming with signs to be observed or with any visible display. Nor will people say, 'Look, here it is,' or 'There it is.' For the Malchut of Elohim, the kingdom, is among you because of my presence." The very presence of Yeshua was the visible Malchut of Elohim. He was the visible kingdom. You could see the kingdom because of his presence. Yeshua was declaring a spiritual truth that Israel did not see. Yohanan, John, chapter 18, verse 36, Yeshua says, "My kingdom is not of this world, nor does it have its origin in this world. If my kingdom were of this world, my servants would be fighting hard to keep me from being handed over to the Jews. But as it is, my kingdom, my Malchut, is not of this world." Just as he says to those Kodeshim, those who were dedicated to him, you're in this world, but you're not of this world. Now, the kingdom of, we looked at the Malchut of Elohim, the kingdom of God. The kingdom of heaven appears 32 times and only in the book of Matthew. Matthew chapter 5, verse 10, Baruch, that is, blessed, comforted by inner peace and Elohim's love, are those who are persecuted for doing that which is morally right. For theirs is the Malchut of heaven, the kingdom of heaven, both now and forever. Theirs is the kingdom of the Shamayim, right now, as well as forever. Matthew 5:19, whoever breaks one of the least important of these commandments and teaches others to do the same will be called least important in the kingdom of heaven, the Malchut of the Shamayim. But whoever practices and teaches them, he will be called great in the Malchut of the Shamayim, kingdom of heaven. Matthew 7:21, not everyone who says to me, Adon, Adon, Master, Master, will enter the Malchut of the Shamayim. Not everyone who calls me Master will enter the kingdom of heaven, but only he who does the will of my Father, Yeshua speaking, who is in the Shamayim, heaven. Matthew chapter 8, verse 11, I say to you, Yeshua speaking again, that many Gentiles will come from east and west and will sit down to feast at the table and enjoy Elohim's promises with Abraham, Avraham, Isaac, Yitzchak, and Jacob, Yaakov, in the kingdom of heaven, the Malchut of the Shamayim, because they accepted me, Yeshua, as Savior. Now, there are those who say that the kingdom of heaven is the inauguration of the renewed covenant on earth without the activation of the visible divine government of Elohim on earth, while the kingdom of God is the visible divine government of Elohim on earth, whether in the past under the first covenant or yet in the future under the renewed covenant. There may be some truth to that, but I don't see any clear-cut definitions that say that is so. Number two, who cares? What difference does it make? You know, people get caught up in these kinds of issues, start arguing, cause dissension. That's the work of Satan. There's no reason to go there. Like I said, who cares? It's not important. Focus on your walk with Elohim, not on trying to own definitions. Oh, you know, this is right, they're wrong, I'm right. You know, don't go there. Whenever it comes to things like that, you know, there are a lot of things that we don't know. And because it's not ours to know at this time. Leave that. Those kinds of things, we'll see later. Let it go. And like I said, focus on your walk with Elohim. Learn how to pitch your tent with him and pay attention to him revealing to you how he pitches his tent with you. These are important issues to search out. Now also, it's entirely possible that the occurrences of Kingdom of God in Matthew's Gospel are not legitimate script. They may have eventually crept into the text through amendments from scribes who were not familiar with the various phrases that were being used in the original Aramaic Hebrew. For example, it's a fact that the Jewish people spoke or wrote the word Shamayim as a substitute for the tetragrammaton, Yod-Heh-Wah-Heh, Yahuwah, the Father's name. You know, they were caught up in that doctrine. Don't speak his name, you know. They were fed lies from Satan. I think it was around 300 years B.C. when the temple was defiled and they started putting out this law. Anyone speaking the Father's name, writing it down, be put to death. And then they started promoting this doctrine, from the Ten Commandments. You know, you shall not take the name, how does it go? In vain. I mean, and that's not what it says. Literally, the original Aramaic Hebrew says, you shall not take my name, Yahuwah, your Elohim, and bring it to nothing. Now, that's quite different than saying, you know, to speak it in vain. So they're like, oh, you know, if we never speak it, then he can't accuse us of speaking it in vain. I mean, that's just wickedness. So anyway, it's known as a fact that the Jewish people spoke or wrote the word Shamayim instead of Yod-Heh-Wah-Heh, the tetragrammaton, the Father's name, Yahuwah. Or other words specifically referring to Elohim, like the word we see in English is God. Another example, when the prophet Daniel wrote in Daniel chapter 4:26 that heaven rules, or the Shamayim rules. He was doing that same thing. The Aramaic, like the Hebrew, Shamayim was used by Daniel as a substitute for the tetragrammaton, as a substitute for the Father's name. You want to take it in vain. I don't know. You know, people were They were just deluded by Satan. Don't take his name in vain. That's not what it says. It says don't bring it to nothing. So you remove it from the book. You brought it to nothing. Anyway, there is clear evidence that this practice of not speaking or using the Father's Kodesh name began in the Babylonian captivity, and I pointed that out in my word studies about the Father's name. Now let's look at the Odiyot. First, let's look at the word for that we see is kingdom in English, and that word is Malchut. It's spelled Mem, Lamed, Kaf, Yod, Tau. Mem, picture of water. The word washes us clean. Yeshua's blood saved us. Mem has to do with mightiness. Lamed, picture of a shepherd's staff. Has to do with the leader, the teacher of the flock. Protecting, steering the sheep. Being yoked. In union with Yeshua. Has to do with discipleship. The Aramaic Hebrew word for disciple is Talmid. For disciples, plural, Talmidim. Then we have Kaf, picture of an open palm. Has to do with taming and subduing the flesh. Has to do with the work of Yeshua. And with the filling, not the receiving of the Ruach, but with the filling of the Ruach. That happens after you receive the Ruach. You keep growing in his word, and you receive more and more of a filling of the Ruach. Then we have Yod, picture of an arm and hand, has to do with work, what one makes, has to do with actions, what someone does, and it has to do with worship, who you worship. And then finally we have Tau, it's a mark or a sign. Yahuwah's signature, a monument. So, the Malchut, the kingdom, is of Yeshua, the word who washes us and who saves us, the leader and teacher of the flock who protects and steers his sheep. He said, you know, you see the kingdom by my very presence. That's what we're seeing with the Odio. The kingdom is Yeshua, who yokes himself to us and makes us his Talmidim, who tames and subdues us and gives us the filling of the Ruach. It's his work, what he made, and his actions, what he has done and what he does. It's the absolute mark of his signature and a monument in all of eternity. Now we look at the word we see in English as heaven. Of course, that never appears. Throughout the entire word, the Aramaic Hebrew word, Shamayim, is plural. It should never say heaven. It should always say heavens. Always. There's not one example in the entire original Aramaic Hebrew scripts of the word, from Genesis through Revelation, Bereshit through Chazon, where we see Shemach, that would be heaven. It's always Shamayim, heavens. And the word is Shamayim. It's spelled Shin, Mem, Yod, Mem. Shin, picture of two front teeth, sharp, cutting, pressing, has to do with a pair and with the second one. Mem, picture of water. The word washes us. Yeshua's blood saved us. Has to do with mightiness. Yod, we just covered, arm and hand. Has to do with work, what we make, actions, what we do. Has to do with worship, who you worship. And then we see Mem again. Water, the word washes us. Yeshua's blood saves us. Mightiness. So, the kingdom of heaven, that is, the Malchut of the Shamayim, separates the Kodeshim from the world, done by a pair, Yahuwah and Yeshua, through the second one, Ruach HaKodesh, and through his word which washes us clean, as well as through Yeshua's blood which saved us. Again, it's the work of Elohim, what he made, and his actions, what he has done. And notice how Yod, his work and his actions, sits in the heart of his word, Mem. Yod is wrapped around with Mem. Then we look at the word we see as God. In the original Aramaic Hebrew, that would be Elohim. It's a plural term, best interpreted in English as mighty ones. Elohim is spelled Aleph, Lamed, He, Yod, Mem. Aleph, picture of an ox head. Has to do with headship, especially in terms of family. Has to do with being yoked to and taught by that headship. Lamed, picture of a shepherd's staff, represents the leader and teacher of the flock, protecting, steering the sheep, being yoked to the leader of the sheep and the teacher, being a Talmid, a Talmidim, disciples. Then we see hey, picture of spiritual man. Look, behold. And hey has to do with revelation from the Ruach and the fifth dimension of spirit. Then we see yod, picture of an arm and a hand, has to do with work, what one makes, actions, what one does, and with worship. Finally, mem, picture of water, the word washes us, Yeshua's blood saves us. Has to do with mightiness. So, Elohim is the headship of our family. The kingdom of Elohim, the kingdom of our Adon, our master. Again, it's pointing at Yeshua. Elohim being the headship of our family. All the family members who are yoked to and taught by him. He is the leader and the teacher of the flock, which he protects and steers. His sheep who worship him in spirit say, look, behold the work and actions of our Creator, Yahuwah, our Elohim, the Word who washes us clean and saves us, Yahuwah, Echad, Yahuwah, is one. So, what's the difference between the kingdom of God and the kingdom of heaven? That is, the malchut of Elohim and the malchut of the Shamayim. How can they be different? The malchut of the Shamayim is the malchut of Elohim. And the malchut of Elohim is the malchut of the Shamayim. The kingdom of God is the kingdom of the heavens. The kingdom of the heavens is the kingdom of God. I don't think there's a distinction between the two. And then some say, when his kingdom is on the earth, that's the millennium. And of course beyond. But again, I don't see any difference. When his kingdom is operating fully on the earth, it's not going to be any different than it is in the Shamayim. The two become echad. They become one. Part of Abba's plan. So, that's our study for this week, my friends. As always, I hope and I pray that this study is a berakha to you and yours. And Abba willing, I'll see you here again next week. Until then, shalom, my friends.
Now 2,000 years have gone by, it's another working day. Some would rather let it lie, but the question still remains.